Mary Gelsler, and welcome to the schoolhouse. If you haven't been here before, isn't it great?
Yeah.
It's really cool. Which leads me right into, we have, we put out a beautiful annual newsletter. And so if you don't have one, I think we have some copies in the back. And we just happen to have an envelope in there. And we accept donations. We welcome them because, as you know, we're a nonprofit. And we do these wonderful things. And it just takes money to keep this place alive. So anything you can contribute, we appreciate it. I think we have a glass jar up there. And we have some wonderful ladies here who made some goodies for you to help yourself at the end of the night. And we have a bathroom. You need that. It's outside. It's an outhouse. And with us, I think that's about it. We have a wonderful speaker here tonight. She's kind of a mystery. I know that word will mean something at that moment. And you must have all like gruesome stuff because you came out to hear the murderous. Great. All right. So with no ado, let me welcome Sharon Saber.
So charming, fun, you just love to have me at your parties. And I have, once in a while, I do things that you would expect you would think. The problem I have is this, that I murdered a lot of people. And I did it very cleverly. I was very scientific about what I did. And I resent the fact that that young woman over in Fall River, that Lizzie, whatever her name is, she is much more famous than I am. And I think that's totally unfair, and I want to let all of you know what I did. I am very famous in this area because I killed four members of the Davis family who were Cataumet residents, all in one summer, and which was a really big mistake on my part, because I really believe that if I had not killed all those people all at once, I wouldn't have attracted such attention to myself, and I could have gotten away with doing murder after murder for a long time. So this is about, I just want you to know the story of my life, what I did. It has been discussed. Why did I do this? What was my motivation? Was I really insane? Because after all, they judged me insane at my trial, and I did go to time to the insane asylum for the rest of my life. But was I really insane, or did I have a profit motive sometimes? So I'll tell you all those things, and see, you can decide what you think about that. I was born in 1857. My name was Nora Kelly. I had, my parents were Peter Kelly and Bridget Kelly. And Bridget, my mother, died when I was very young. So I was so young that I don't remember her at all. My father, I wish I didn't remember him because he was so bad. He was a drunk, he was abusive, and he eventually brought me and my sister, who was a little bit older, Delia, to the Boston Female Asylum for Destitute Girls, which was a big improvement over where I'd been living before, I'll tell you. My father was actually judged insane a little later. And the way that they knew he was insane was that he was a tailor and he sewed his eyelid, own eyelid, shut. That would be a good clue. So,
what's wrong?
Fortunately, after I went to the orphanage, I didn't have to see him anymore. Now, what they did with these girls who were in the orphanage, they would let them go home and live with other, you know, households. A family would decide that they wanted a girl, and they could sign them out, and they could sign legal papers, it was an apprenticeship-style agreement. And the girl would go home with that family and be taught how to do household chores, cooking, cleaning, and so on. And in some cases, I think it was almost like slave labor. In my case, it wasn't. I really, the people that took me home with them, the Thomas, they were very good people. The only problem was that Mrs. Thomas kept reminding me that I was kind of from an inferior race of people, you know, the Irish. So I was, and that was about the only problem I had. And with the Thomas, they gave me a good education, and I actually lived with that family until I was 28 years old. They had a daughter who was about 10 years older than me, and I was friendly with her at that time. So, when I finally reached the age of 28, I really had to do something. Now, young women today have a really easy time with it because they can go into any profession they want. Well, there's a very limited choice for me. So I could have gotten married and become somebody's wife, or I could have become a housekeeper, domestic servant of some kind, or I could have become a nurse, and that's about all the choices that I had. So I decided to become a nurse, which was very fortunate for me, especially considering my proclivities, because I was able to learn all about the poisons and medications and how much to give somebody just to make them sick, how much to give them to actually kill them. So that was the nurse's training was really excellent for me, and I found out as I went through this nurse's training, I was working in hospitals, and people didn't watch every move I made. I found that I could actually steal things from some patients, little bits of money or small valuables. And I also was able to really experiment with morphine and atropine. I found that with morphine, that would really put somebody to sleep, sometimes permanently. And with atropine, it would change the pupil of the eye. The morphine dilated the eye, and the atropine closed the eye back up so that there wasn't the evidence there that something had gone awry. Well, so I did all these things during nurse's training, and I was at Cambridge, was at the hospital there, and they, my supervisor, I don't think he was suspicious of me, but he thought I was careless with the medications that I gave, so I was dismissed from the Cambridge Hospital. I didn't mind that at all because I then was loose. I was able to make my own contracts with people, and the doctors liked me. They really, they were very complimentary of me and my skills, and they recommended me to private patients. So I found that private working at somebody's home was much, number one, was much more lucrative than working in the hospital. And number two, it gave me opportunities that I didn't have in the hospital that I was able probably, I did a lot of little thefts, and I really don't know how I got away with it, but I did. So that was what I was doing. I was doing private nursing. Now, the first time I came to Cataumet was in 1896. And the Ferdinand family were renting a cottage from the Davis family. The Davis family had started the first really seaside hotel in this area. And that building, is half of it is still standing. It's on the Nansen Road, fairly near the railroad bridge. So the Davis family were very prominent in the community, and they owned the cottage. The cottage is now 19th Mystery Lane. It looks quite different from what it did at that time. Because later owners did some renovations and made it clear. It was a little bridge, and there's a little square thing on top of a very flat roof. One of the owners, I don't know when this happened, but sometime they took that off and peeked the roof, made it more like a normal house, and so the snow would run off or melt and run off in the winter. So, anyway, 19 Mystery Lane was the cottage and that the Ferdinands were in. So I was there with the Ferdinand family for a couple, 3 years, and then because I was so nice to everybody in the community, everybody thought I was just wonderful. They asked my advice on medical issues. I was very happy to share my knowledge. I took children to the beach, and I was just always a very helpful person. And the Davises thought a lot of me. So when I decided that I wanted to rent that cottage myself, they were very willing to give me a good price. So they rented the cottage to me for $250 per summer. As you may notice, the prices have since gone up. I'm not used to this. We didn't have this back in my day. So the Davises had rented to me. Now, I was doing private nursing. I was up in Cambridge, and I was boarding with a family named the Beadle family. And Mrs. Davis decided that she had waited long enough for the rent money that I owed, which was about $500, which is a lot of money for me. I really didn't have the $500. So she came into the Beadle house, but she fell on her way to the train. And Mrs. Davis, more than she was elderly, she was in her 60s, you know. And she fell down, and it was a very hot day. We were having a hot wave here, and she was very disconcerted. She fell down on the way to catch the train when she was hurrying, and people helped her into the train, even though some people thought she shouldn't have gone. But she did. She went on up to Cambridge. She came to where I was boarding. She had dinner with us and then said she was so tired and exhausted. And I said, oh my dear, you need a little honey on your water. So I poured a little few additions into the water and gave them to Mrs. Davis. And she was soon ready for bed, so she went to bed, but she was ill. And the next day, she was not better. She was just could not get out of bed. So I contacted her husband, and he came up, but he couldn't do anything about it. I had no idea. I wanted to discharge my dad. And the best way to get rid of that debt was to get rid of Mrs. Davis. So I, at for several days. I gave her a little bit of poison here and there. Then I finally gave her one massive dose. And in seven days, she died. Well, the whole family, the Davis family, was very distraught about this, you can imagine. Mrs. Davis was one of her grown daughters who was living in Chicago, had come to meet with her and perhaps do a little shopping in Boston. And this daughter's name is Genevieve Ward. She was very, very, very upset when Mrs. Davis died. The other daughter was Mary Gibbs, called Minnie. She lived in Pocatso over here. She was the wife of a sea captain. Well, I offered to go with Mrs. Davis to ride with the casket back to Cataumet, move in with the Davis family to help them. This was one of my charges, was to be of service to people. So I found that Genevieve, which was the youngest daughter, was so distraught and so upset, and I felt so sorry for her, that I thought she might be better off on the other side. So I said, Genevieve, have some money. So she did. She was pretty soon she was going to. Well, you can imagine a father who had just lost his wife, and now he had lost his youngest daughter, and he was very, very, very upset. Not only that, but he had a lot of money in his wallet, and he had the contract that I owed the rent for previous summers. So I decided Mr. Davis needed to be the next person to go. So one day, when I had an opportunity, I just gave him a good solid dose of morphine, put him to bed, and the next morning, one of his grandchildren ran up to see what was wrong with Grandpa and found that he was not moving. So Mr. Davis was gone. Now, this left only Minnie, who was the, as I said, the wife of Irving Gibbs, who was the sea captain. Irving Gibbs' father's name was Paul. And Paul Gibbs started to get a little bit suspicious and became more suspicious after I murdered his daughter-in-law as well. She, Harry Gordon was there, and he said to Mary, you really should talk to Jane about collecting that rent. Well, you know, I thought I'd heard enough about that rent. I wouldn't have been able to pay it anyway. I didn't have the money. So I offered many years as well. And she was, you know, these girls, I should feel guilty for leaving their children without their mothers, but I don't. I don't know. Something maybe is wrong. I'm not sure. So, I want you to know that the Davises were not my first victims. And in addition to the people that I killed who were in the hospital when I was studying nursing, I also killed one couple who were my landlords, and I did that because I didn't want to pay the rent. It seems like I was always getting out of the rent. And the other, another person that I killed was actually a good friend of mine. And she was in charge of the mess hall at the Marine Biological Lab in Woods Corner. And I wanted her job. She was in the mess hall there, and she was also in charge at a theological seminary mess hall in Cambridge in the winter time. So I wanted her job. I got rid of her, and guess what? I got the job. Which was probably unfortunate because I actually had no training for doing that, and I was a miserable failure at it, and I got fired. So that marker really didn't do a game. The other person that I murdered, in fact, I murdered her at 19 Mr. Lane. She was my foster sister. She was Tom's daughter. I invited her down. She was staying at my house that I rented. This was in 1899, I just said. She was very happy. We went to the beach. We had a good time. And then it was very warm, though. And so we got back. She was ready for bed. I gave her a good dose. She had left me $200 in her will, and I knew that. But the bad thing about it was that I never did get the money. They never gave me the money. I'm not sure why that was, but that's what happened. So she was one of my victims. Now, the Davis family—they were a really good family, and they stuck close together. And Captain Paul Gibbs, the father-in-law of Minnie Gibbs, was very upset, and he knew that something was going on. But I had murdered two young, healthy women. All of a sudden, it was just way too much. So he insisted, he pulled some strings, contacted Leonard Wood from the Passet, contacted the authorities, and had the authorities dig up the Davis's bodies. By this time, I had left the town, and I was going to stay with my foster sister's husband. And I had hopes there because I could use a husband. But he was not biting at the bait, I'm afraid. I'm really quite upset. I had gone to his house. I had actually he had a sister who was staying there. He had a housekeeper who was staying there. I was afraid that they would stand in my way, so I just murdered them. Then Mr. Brigham, my target, I decided that I would curry favor with him, so I gave him just a little bit of poison, just enough to make him sick. And that way I was able to be very attentive and very nice to him, and nurse him back to health, and I was hoping that would clinch the deal for me, but it didn't. He didn't bite. So I told him that I was pregnant and I was going to accuse him of being the father of the baby. Well, at that, he said, okay, get out of here. So he threw me out, really. Wise man. Yeah. I went on up to New Hampshire and stayed with some friends. And it was while I was there that I was arrested. Now, I think that the reason that I didn't get as much press coverage nationwide as I might have otherwise is that all this was happening at the time that President McKinley was assassinated. In fact, the day I was arrested, was the very day that Leon Chodas, the assassin, was executed. So that was one of the explanations. I said I didn't envision that I would have been really, really famous, and I'm not. Elroy Sedgwick, a writer long years past, said that I was the champion of American murder without equal. Pretty nice compliment. During the trial, at first they were looking for, they exhumed those bodies. And one murder that they thought they could prove was that of Genevieve Davis Gordon. They were trying to find evidence of arson. Because what do you think? Of course, when you think of arson, well, I didn't use arsenic. So they did find arsenic in the body, but it was arsenic that was used when the body was embalmed. And that was proved. So finally, they found that the bodies were full of morphine and atropine. Now, when they were doing all this, when they were prosecuting me, they had alienists interview. That's what they called psychologists in those days. And I tried to be as honest as I could with them. I also kind of was thinking that if these aliens said that I was insane, that maybe instead of getting a death penalty, that I might be sent to an insane asylum, and then I would be cured, and they would release me. Well, I'll tell you, that never happened, because they never let me out. They sent me to the Taunton Insane Asylum, and I stayed there the rest of my long life. I lived to be 81, and I died in 1938. So I was in the Taunton Asylum for a very, very long time. I had hoped, really, that I had thought I would be released, but this never happened. But I just adjusted to the situation and just put up with it. As I can, but one thing that I didn't like at all was that they kept trying to poison me. I would like to be able to ask you, all of you, if you have any questions or observations, or maybe some of you know something about this story that would like to share it.
I've heard that you curled up in bed with people before they were taken down completely. And were you getting your jollies off?
Well, you know, I... Yes. Yes, I was. And I neglected to mention that because I thought it might be too gruesome a detail to mention in this nice company.
I had heard that there was a doctor at the end of Barlow's Landing Road down by the landing that had first become suspicious and talked to a doctor friend in her Cataumet, and the two of them were the ones who really started the whole movement to check on you. Is that correct?
Well, I think so, because there were several people. There were doctors, a couple doctors involved, and so on. And I don't know. I know that there were people who were in from the state who were investigating. I think that they have been, become suspicious. But yes, yes, there were. I don't know all their names. I don't remember, because after all, I am over 150 years old.
But, and the captain gives, there are many captain gives on Marlowe's land and roses. Which one was that?
Well, I don't know exactly how they were related here, but her Minnie's husband was Captain Irving Gibbs, and his father was Paul. So.
Yes. Did the address Mystery Lane exist before you lived there, or did it stay after that?
When we first moved there, it was Washington Street, and then a year or two later, they changed the name of the street in honor of me.
Yeah, how much time elapsed between the autopsy, or the death, and then the autopsy?
That's a good question. I'm going to give you an estimate. Probably a month or 6 weeks.
So 19 Mystery Lane is actually where Jolly Jane, a.k.a. Sharon, lives. And my question is, do you ever get a sense or a presence that Jane's around?
I guess I'll go back to being Sharon now. Actually, no. But my kids, when they were little, oh my gosh. All these windows are the original ones, you know. So when the wind blows, you hear the windows rattling, etc. And my kids were absolutely convinced that Jane was there.
Did you stay in touch with your birth sister, and did she suffer mental illness as well?
Yes, she did. She was, she died young. And I'm not sure. I'm sure. I read one account that said that Jane and that Martin had an older sister who had been committed to an insane asylum. But the one that went into the orphanage with me, I know that she died young. George?
Oh, that was great. I've never heard such broad detail. But I did want the doctor involved with Lenny Rose, Leonard Wood, who was involved with the Philippines, who was a general MD, I think.
Right, he was at San Juan Hill.
There's one thing I'd like to add, and it's probably the only plus side of this ledger. When Ellery Sedgwick, I haven't had this book, when Ellery Sedgwick was a freshman sophomore at Harvard, he got pneumonia. And his nurse was Jan Top, and I'll have to show you this passage. And at that time in his life, he was very appreciative of Jan Top, because she nursed him literally back to life when he finished his career, found the Atlantic Monthly, etc. So it was only later on.
Not only later on, but older people. Because Jade said older people should not live so long. And that was already a lot of months ago. Ellery said, you know, there were many, many people that she nursed that she was did very well. She took very good care of them, probably by far. Most of her patients, she took very good care of. Yes.
What was the name of the woman who had the job at the MDR?
Myra Connors. Myra Connors.
What was your total count?
Total count.
was tried for the murder. I, in my confession, I delineated and identified 31 people that I could remember and remember the details. But now, you know, if I could remember 31, you know that there were some that I had forgotten. So, and some people thought that I might have murdered as many as 100 people all over the mainland, which is almost impossible to tell because a lot of people, you know, in those days, if old people died, that was natural. So, I could kill somebody and it just wouldn't look like anything special to him. So, yes.
Where are you getting all the morphine that's
happening? I got the morphine and atropine at the pharmacies in Falmouth and Ware. They, the authorities checked up on me and they knew I bought no arsenic, but that I had bought, purchased atropine and morphine at both of those pharmacies, and quite a bit of it. More than one would
have been.
Anybody else have a question? Yes.
You mentioned that you thought they were trying to poison you in the insane side. Is that a product of your directed imagination?
Yes, it was. Yes. They actually, it was pretty mental because what they did was they actually put a feeding tube in. And they dumped the powder and put it in there. You know, I'm sure that was not a very pleasant experience. In fact, she, Jane wrote letters to that effect that people were mistreating her, particularly with the feeding and trying to give her food that was poisoned or not edible. So she was a pretty miserable person.
So, Jane, where are your letters now? Are they accessible to people?
I didn't see the original letters. there are a lot of one-dimensionals. There are a lot of websites that have information. Some of it's contradictory and so on, but if you just Google Jane Cobham Murder or Jane Cobham Cataumet, you get a lot of websites. But there are, there's one that the study was done by two people who were working on a master's degree in history. They had quite a nice timeline. They had the dates and all of the events in Jane's life and mother. So if you're interested in that, that's
good. And there is a Lowe's critique harbor. And after her, it's rumored to be kind of like a flying touch.
So let's fast forward to today. How the chairman was so intrigued with this very detailed mystery.
You know what? I don't actually know. I was asked to do a presentation for the Society of Historical Preservation when they do their trolley tour. I think the youngest one's in charge of that. She asked me. I could try, I could tell about it, and then I sort of just kind of fell into it, and it was fun. I enjoyed doing it. So. Anything else, anybody?
Sure.
Yes.
Did you have any visitors in the 37 years you were in Cataumet?
None, except for my lawyer and my physician. That's all. Nobody. I'm buried in Potter's Field up at the insane asylum. There's no marker, but they do have a record of who is buried where. There's a plot number on in the insane asylum. because they don't call it that sun asylum now, but there is a map of the plot so they know where she is. It's not marked.
Yeah. Did you ever get in contact with Lizzie Borden or correspond with her?
Oh, no, I didn't like Lizzie Borden.
Did she know about you?
Well, she kind of knew it. I thought she did. She was, you know, she was acquitted. She killed two parents with an axe, and then she was acquitted. Oh, my.
Good lawyer.
Good lawyer, he said. Did I skip anything, babe? My husband did. Okay.
Mary Gelsler, and welcome to the schoolhouse. If you haven't been here before, isn't it great?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's really cool. Which leads me right into, we have, we put out a beautiful annual newsletter. And so if you don't have one, I think we have some copies in the back. And we just happen to have an envelope. And we accept donations. We welcome them because, as you know, we're a nonprofit, and we do these wonderful things, and it just takes money to keep this place alive. So anything you can contribute, we appreciate it. I think we have a glass jar out there. And we have some wonderful ladies here who made some goodies for you to help yourself at the end of the night. And we have a bathroom. You need that. It's outside. It's an outhouse. And with this, I think that's an idea. We have a wonderful speaker here tonight. She's quite a mystery. I know that word will mean something. Yeah, that means something. And you must have all like gruesome stuff because you came out to hear the murderous. Great. So with no ado, let me welcome Sharon Saber.
I'd like to thank all of you for coming here tonight because my name is Jolly Jane Toppin. I'm called Jolly because I'm so charming and fun. You just love to have me at your parties. And once in a while, I do things that you wouldn't expect. I'm back to myself. The problem I have is this, that I murdered a lot of people. And I did it very cleverly. I was very scientific about what I did. And I resent the fact that that young woman over the Fall River, that Lizzie, whatever her name is, she is much more famous than I am, and I think that's totally unfair, and I want to let all of you know what I did. I am very famous in this area because I killed four members of the Davis family, who were Cataumet residents, all in one summer, and which was a really big mistake on my part because I really believe that if I had not killed all those people all at once, I wouldn't have attracted such attention to myself, and I could have gotten away with doing murder after murder for a long time. So, this is that I just want you to know the story of my life, what I did. It has been discussed. Why did I do this? What was my motivation? Was I really insane? Because after all, they judged me insane. My trial, and I did go to time to the insane asylum for the rest of my life. But was I really insane, or did I have a profit motive sometimes? So I'll tell you all those things, and see, you can decide what you think about that. I was born in 1857. My name was Nora Kelly. I had my parents were Peter Kelly and Bridget Kelly. And Bridget, my mother, died when I was very young. So I was so young that I don't remember her at all. My father, I wish I didn't remember him because he was so bad. He was a drunk, he was abusive, and he eventually brought me and my sister, who was a little bit older, Delia, to the Boston Female Asylum for Destitute Girls, which was a big improvement over where I'd been living before, I'll tell you. My father was actually judged insane a little later, and the way that they knew me was insane was that he was a tailor and he sewed his own eyelids shut. That would be a good clue. So,
what's wrong?
Fortunately, after I went to the orphanage, I didn't have to see him anymore. Now, what they did with these girls who were in the orphanage, they would let them go home and live with other, households. A family would decide that they wanted a girl, and they could sign them out, and they could sign legal papers, it was an apprenticeship-style agreement. And the girl would go home with that family and be taught how to do household chores, cooking, cleaning, and so on. And in some cases, I think it was almost like slave labor. In my case, it wasn't. I really, the people that took me home with them, the Thomas, they were very good people. The only problem was that Mrs. Thomas kept reminding me that I was kind of from an inferior race of people, the Irish. So I was, and that was about the only problem in my head. And with the Thomas, they gave me a good education, and I actually lived with that family until I was 28 years old. They had a daughter who was about 10 years older than me, and I was friendly with her at that time. So, when I finally reached the age of 28, I really had to do something. Really easy time because they could go into any profession they want. Well, there was a very limited choice for me. I could have gotten married and become somebody's wife, or I could have become a housekeeper, domestic servant of some kind, or I could have become a nurse, and that's about all the choices that I had. So I decided to become a nurse, which was very fortunate for me. Especially considering my proclivities, because I was able to learn all about poisons and medications and how much to give somebody just to make them sick, how much to give them to actually kill them. So that was the nurse's training was really excellent for me, and I found out as I went. As nurses trained, I was working in hospitals, and people did watch every move I made. I found that I could actually steal things from some patients, little bits of money or small valuables. And I also was able to really experiment with morphine and atropine. I found that with morphine, that would really put somebody to sleep, sometimes permanently. And with atropine, it would change the pupil of the eye. Morphine dilated the eye, and the atropine closed the eye back up, so that there wasn't the evidence there that something had gone awry. Well, so I learned, did all these things during nurses training, and I was at Cambridge, was at the hospital there, and they, my supervisor, I don't think he was suspicious of me, but he thought I was careless with the medications that I gave, so I was dismissed from the Cambridge hospital. I didn't mind that at all, because I then was loose. I was able to make my own contracts with people, and the doctors liked me. They really, they were very complimentary of me and my skills, and they recommended me to private patients. So I found that private working in somebody's home was much, number one, was much more lucrative than working in the hospital, and number two, it gave me opportunities that I didn't have in the hospital, that I could, because they were probably, they did a lot of little thefts, and I really don't know how I got away with it, but I did. So that was what I was doing. I was doing private nursing. Now, the first time I came to Cataumet was in 1896. And the Ferdinand family were renting a cottage from the Davis family. The Davis family had started the first really seaside hotel in this area. And that building, is half of it is still standing. It's on the Gansett Road, fairly near the railroad bridge. So the Davis family were very prominent in the community, and they owned the cottage. The cottage is now 19th Mystery Lane. It looks quite different from what it did at that time. Because later owners did some renovations, and there was a little bridge, and there's a little square thing on top of a very flat roof. One of the owners, I don't know when this happened, but sometime they took that off and peeked the roof, made it more like a normal house, and so the snow would run off or melt and run off in the winter. So, anyway, 19 Mystery Lane was the cottage and that the Ferdinands were in it. So I was there with the Ferdinand family for a couple of 3 years, and then because I was so nice to everybody in the community, everybody thought I was just wonderful. They asked my advice on medical issues. I was very happy to share my knowledge. I took children to the beach, and I was just always a very helpful person. And the Davises thought a lot of me. So when I decided that I wanted to rent that cottage myself, good price. So they rented the